have the biggest song in the country. Now is about your family, about your career, about you accomplishing everything you ever wanted.
Rapper XXXTentacion,
artist whose real name is Jose Onfroy,
has been shot.
He was a kid. He was exciting. He was polarizing. I knew people wouldn't forget him.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah.
There's definitely a difference between Jose Onfroy and XXXTentacion. Jose Onfroy was weak. Nobody cared about Jose Onfroy until he took on the persona as XXX.
You know how you got that little voice in your head and it'd be like, yo, don't do that. I don't think he had that.
Y'all mad I'm successful? Suck my...
I remember him telling me, I'm making music for the broken people, for the people that feel how I feel.
Look at me. He was an incredible talent. He should not be anyone's idol.
People didn't want to be around him. That was his biggest battle, himself.
My son would not sleep at night. He would tell me he hears voices. They told me that he was bipolar.
Darkness sells. He was getting more famous by the day.
The thing about his fame started with this horrific alleged crime.
It was kind of like a fairy tale, but a really grim one. There was a lot of jealousy.
I could hear them fighting. Somebody was getting hit.
Jesse was like, no, mom, it's not true. And a part of me took that and run with it.
We was born into a world that taught us that men have to fight. But your weapon can be the same thing that kills you. There's some issues where people just need to be put away. But there's some issues where people need help, especially kids. He did not want that image to follow him around for the rest of his life.
Boom, I, someone that's afraid to let go.
Oh, that's nice. That's dope.
I apologize. I haven't been getting the help I really want.
I think he was changing, but he hurt others and himself.
He realized he had an obligation that was bigger than himself.
To do what he's done in 2 years, whether you loved it or whether you hated it, you just had to acknowledge it.
Boom, there you go. That was a trailer for Look At Me coming to Hulu this Thursday, May 26th. And as you see on the screen, I have a special guest, Sabaah Folayan. Thank you so much for coming here, giving me your time today. I know we've been trying to make this work, and so I'm so excited that we can make this work today.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Kuya.
Definitely, definitely. So truly a pleasure again to see you. Let's get it going. Let's get it cracking. So how did you get involved with this project? I know you've been amazing with all of the work you do. There couldn't have been a better person chosen to finish this up and present it. Tell me how you got involved with telling this story.
Yeah, so I was invited to interview by someone who I'd gone to school with, who sort of knew that I had a background in mental health. He knew that I had worked in reentry dealing with people who were incarcerated. And so he knew that I had like sort of an extra little perspective, and I'm really glad that he put me up for it. I went into the interview kind of guns blazing because of the controversy. I wanted to make sure that I was clear out the gate. Hey, these are my values. It has to be honest. You know, I see the mental health angle. I see the way that the criminal justice system, you know, really failed in this situation. And I also believe that survivors more times than not tell the truth because there is so little incentive to come forward after experiences of abuse, and that we would have to tell the truth in this film if I was going to be the one to tell it. So when they were open to that, that was really exciting to me because it meant that we could create something that was going to be a tool and a resource to help people who are also dealing with these issues.
I love that. Props on that. You came in there knowing what you wanted to do. And that's so important. And I hope one of the biggest things that's taken away from this is how important mental health is and self-care and talking about what you're feeling. And so I'm curious, as this started, you know, you started getting involved with this project, you started putting it together because, unfortunately, you know, he had passed. What was it like working and talking to the family and you know, just all of that connection that you were getting to help build this into this documentary? What was the vibe that you were getting to construct this story?
Yeah, it was challenging. The thing that was first in the front of my mind was that this was a family that was grieving. And I wanted to make sure that everything I did with a certain amount of respect and care, because, you know, anyone who's lost a loved one, you know what kind of space that is. And so I couldn't come at it like just a corporate job. I had to come at it with the extra level of sensitivity. Yeah, I think that was a big thing. And then the other thing is just understanding that these are also folks who are business people and who are in entertainment, you know, and they have their own personal perspectives and their own personal goals. And so I decided early on that transparency and honesty was going to be my approach, that anything that comes up, we're going to talk about it. We can talk about the why. We can talk about how filmmaking works and why this question needs to be asked and this material needs to be in it. I knew it wasn't going to be a situation where I just, you know, take everything, go by myself and do it, that they were going to continue, because they had already started attempting to make a documentary before I came on board, so that they were going to want to continue to be collaborators. And so I figured as long as we could talk about anything, then we would get through this together. And that's exactly what we did.
I love that. I love that. And it's so important that we work together. You know, sometimes there's a very crab mentality in when we're presenting certain materials about people that are going to be kind of like this existing piece out there. I recently saw online that his mother, stated Cleopatra, I believe is her name, that this project really humanizes her son. Can you talk to me about, you know, from that family standpoint again, and some of that commentary? And did you hear that she said that?
Yeah. I heard that she said that, and I knew that was important to her from the very beginning. And it was also important to me, you know, because the fact of the matter is abuse is committed by human beings. You know, we dehumanize ourselves when we try to dehumanize anybody else, no matter what it is that they've done. And I know that that's very uncomfortable because, you know, a lot of us can honestly say we have never and would never do something like that. Nevertheless, human beings are doing this every single day. And if we want to see an end to it, then we have to understand it from a human perspective. So I can only imagine what it feels like for a mother, you know, to see the way that things were polarized around her son. And I'm happy that, you know, my mission and her desire as a mother were able to align like that.
Love that. Love that. I saw also that 50 Cent gave it a 10. 21 Savage really enjoyed it. Fivio Foreign, what do you hope the people get, you know, along with humanizing and telling this story? What do you think is the most important message that you'd like to sit with the fans? Let's start there.
Yeah. You know, I wanted to show respect to the fans for what they went through in the process of following and caring for him, because I think, you know, the connection was real. The ways that people were connecting to him, finding their only, the first time they could be honest about their emotions, or finding that they weren't alone for the first time, and then losing that figure and having the world not understand that, you know, that's a form of a traumatic impact for a young person to be going through, to be feeling that much more misunderstood. So I hope that I could bring some understanding for those people who did find peace in him. It's not that they're horrible people that just like bad people. It's that he was so much more than that. You know, whether we like it or not, those are the facts. And I think that's the world that social media has created, where gatekeepers don't get to decide who's important anymore. The masses have the ability to decide who and what matters. And they decided that this was an important person. And he touched a whole lot of people's lives.
I feel that. And it's reading across from everything you're saying here. And I love it. I have to ask you on a different perspective as a filmmaker and as a documentarian with the work that you do. I know what it means for me as a person of color creating these stories. What does it mean for you to be behind the camera and showing these stories of us? You know, sometimes when white people do it, I don't like, you know, I can't go with that. I need us to tell our stories. Can you just talk to me about that importance of us giving our shine to our people and representing behind the camera?
Yeah. Absolutely. That's another big reason why I wanted to take on this challenge, because it was like, this is a project that's going to happen sooner or later. And the fact, the opportunity that it could be me, and I know who I am, and I know what I'm about, and I know the love that I have, and I know the opportunities that's within hip hop to actually create healing, to actually have conversations, but it's always in the hands of an outsider, and all they want to do is party and make money off of it. They don't realize that this is something so much deeper that concerns our survival and our evolution. So I was just really grateful. It felt like something that was assigned to me from the ancestors. It felt like, you know, part of a really larger mission at play. And so Yeah, you know, when your number gets called, you kind of just have to answer it. That was a big part of what this moment felt like for me.
I love it. Well, I got to thank you from on behalf of the entire POC filmmaking community for putting that work in, telling that Who Street story, what happened with Michael Brown in Missouri, now with XXXTENTACION. Everybody check it out when it drops on Hulu on May 26th. Any other work we can hopefully, you know, support and see you in the future? And maybe if we can throw them socials out there so people can check you out online?
Yes, please follow me at Sabaah Folayan, S-A-B-A-A-H-F-O-L-A-Y-A-N. That's on all socials. And stay tuned. You know, I'm looking for opportunities to learn and grow. I'm the type of person that I like to wait for the right invitation or the right moment to be of service. So I'll be, you know, traveling and learning and having conversations and connecting with people and taking that time. You have to get input in order to do output. So that's what mode I'm in right now. And
I like that we need to get that input in order to give that output. I love that line. Well, this is truly a pleasure. And I might have to hit you up if you're doing like a talk, because as a Filipino filmmaker, I'm trying to tell my stories about us Filipino Americans and Filipinos that came over, that immigrant story. And you are amazing. And I can't thank you enough for giving us this work. Everybody, check out Sabaah with Look At Me, XXXTENTACION drops on Hulu May 26th. I'll have her links as well online. Give her all the love, all the follows. We got to get that input in order to give that output, y'all.
Absolutely. Thank you, Kuya. Let's stay in touch. Appreciate
Most
you.
Definitely, y'all. Love y'all. And our we'll be right back.